some work I did on the French stock exchanges with my colleagues, Pierre Cerillo, Hautecoeur, Amir Reza is just over there, and Eugene White. The basic idea is to present an overview on the organization and working of the Parisian stock exchanges, more than French stock exchanges, has been a little ambitious in proposing the title, during the Belle Epoque, let's say between the beginning of the 1880s up to the World War I. I will give you just some snapshot, I hope some snapshot telling a current story. But first of all, I hope that you will not be disappointed after my presentation, because I'm an economic historian. So I've some instrument in my box that is different from the one that you are used to. What are the instrument, the peculiar instrument in my box? But first of all, an extensive and if possible, critical reading of archives. What is good, because I can access private information that sometimes is not available for nowadays analysis. Second, maybe a peculiar way to build a database. We have to look around for a lot of sources. We have to combine them, because the sources delivering all the needed information just doesn't exist. The combination of the sources changes over time, and because maybe you have one source in the archives for some years, but then the source disappear, then we have to look for a new one. And at the end of the process, you have a huge amount of paper with a lot of number printed on, and you have to put them into a database, if possible, in a smart way. So we are, for the moment, we are not as lucky as our American friend who have this wonderful database, the CRSP database. This morning, Maurizio showed you data from the CRSP database. I think that also your data comes from the CRSP. Yes, then it's really a wonderful database storing the prices of the share listed at the New York Stock Exchange from the 1976 onward. For France, this tool for the moment doesn't exist, and this is why Pierre Cerillo, Hautecoeur and I, we are running a project sponsored by the French National Agency for Research to build a database covering more or less two centuries of stock exchange life. Basically, we are getting prices of stocks, bonds, public bonds, French and foreign ones, from the very beginning of the 19th century up to the 1976. 1976 to match the existing Eurofidai database. We have just started, then for the moment, I've accumulated data on the French Stock Exchange, of course, but about prices, I've accumulated data for selected years. Selected years, why? Which is the criterion of selection, but the years has been chosen to test changes in the market organization. So I'm not a lot to tell you about asset pricing and so forth. This is why the theoretical framework of the work I'm going to present today is more is related to the microstructure literature. I'm sure that you have in mind this kind of literature. So I don't spend time on that. And on the other hand, what is called macrostructure literature. The expression is a bit more exotic. It's coined by Craig Pirron, but basically it's industrial economics applied to the stock exchange industry. Then, what are the issues I'm interested in? But from a microstructure point of view, the risk. We know that the organization of this change affects the risk that investors, as well as market operators like brokers and dealers, can take. The transparency, dissemination of the information within the market and among the market. Transaction cost, we know that the main transaction costs are related to liquidity. From a microstructure point of view, the main question is related to the pros and cons of consolidation versus fragmentation of order flows. Let me say the pros and cons of different degrees of fragmentation. Because we have a lot of models explaining that consolidation is the natural and optimal output of competition. But if you look around, you see many markets, then the unique market doesn't exist. Why the consolidation should be the optimal output of competition? But everybody is happy if in a unique market because of externalities, economies of scales, economies of scope, possibility of diversification, and so forth. There are other models explaining the existence of various markets, introducing heterogeneous preferences of operator. And according to this model, a system based on well-differentiated market is better, just because every agent finds the setting he prefers. If in a system based on a unique market, if an agent doesn't find the setting he likes, but just he leaves the market, okay? Evidently, there are interaction between the two dimensions, because if a stock exchange modifies a parameter of its microstructure, it changes its competitive position in the industry. Okay, this issue are at the center of important policy debate in Europe and the US. Just a couple of words on the regulation that motivated some of the paper I'm going to present to you from a policy point of view. The Marketing Financial Instrument Directive has removed all the existing monopolies over the financial transactions in Europe. Then it lowered the barriers to entry into the industry, and a huge number of new trading venues emerges. From 2007, when the directive came into force, more than 100 trading venues has been created in Europe. The EMIR directive, on the other side, concerns the OTC derivatives trading market. Basically, this directive said, okay, derivatives trading is important, but it's risky, particularly if the trading is done in OTC market. Then, if we put all the OTC derivatives trading into clearing houses, the world will be better because more transparent, thanks to the register function of the clearing houses, and safer, thanks to the central counterparty function of the clearing houses. Basically, the central counterparty is a mutual guarantee over the contracts. So, I'm going to try during this presentation to give you an idea on the functioning of the Paris stock exchanges along this dimension. Well, the Paris Bourse is the second largest stock exchange in the 19th century, after London. The overall market capitalization just before the World War I is 3.656 times the GDP, and the domestic stock capitalization is 0.6 times the GDP. More or less, the 50% of the overall GDP is due to foreign securities, then really a well internationalized market. But unlike New York and London, the Paris Bourse is primarily a derivative market. Forward trading, not future, but forward trading, and option. from the very beginning of the 19th century. The brokers of the off-chain markets has a legal monopoly over the financial transaction, and the number of these brokers, of pure brokers, is established by the law. And the price of the monopoly is the unlimited liability of the brokers. They are liable without limits for the contracts they trade. So the problem of the counterparty risk in this exchange was chronic. Okay? And the solution that the exchange found in the 1822 is the creation of a common fund to provide a mutual guarantee. But if you say mutual guarantee, you say moral hazard. Okay? And the solution that the Stock Exchange Committee finds for the moral hazard, but clearly is related to tough regulation and tough monitoring. Nevertheless, the broker of the exchange resists to the implementation of these rules. Why? But simply because these rules lower the return of the broker on the exchange. So basically the argument of the Stock Exchange Committee that is formed by brokers is the following one. Okay, we have a monopoly, we have a monopoly rents. So please, if you take less risk, the market will be more stable, and we minimize the risk that the Minister of Finance, the government, removes the monopoly. Okay, that's the basic argument. On the other side, you have brokers that say, okay, I paid a lot my seat, I need to trade a lot in order to get higher returns to remunerate my investment. On the other side, the tort rules create also scope for an OTC market, an illegal one, and indeed it emerges during the 30s when the first rule against to limit the moral hazard problem has been put in place. Because in the 30s we have an enormous increase in the demand for stock exchange services. So along the 19th century we have in the Paris financial center two well differentiated exchange. The heterogeneity of the microstructures implies specialization. In the off-chain market, at least more trading of relatively more trading of French securities. On the OTC, relatively more trading on foreign ones. On the off-chain market, a higher proportion of spot trading, while on the OTC market, we have a higher proportion of derivatives trading. The competition between the two markets is at the margin. They compete for the derivative trading of highly liquid foreign French public bonds, just because they are the more profitable segment of the market, to the extent to which these securities are the object of international arbitrage. So, we arrive at the biggest crisis, the most severe crisis of the 19th century, the 1882 crisis. What is going on in France? But evidently, before the crisis, an important boom. That's the three classical explanations for this boom. First of all, the French investor learn about security thanks to the issue of the Emprunt de Libération Nationale. What happens? In 1870, it is a war between France and Prussia. Prussia wins. It occupies an important part of the French territories. And the French government has to pay 5 billion of francs to the Prussia to make the territories free. 5 billion of francs are more or less the 20% of the French GDP in 1873. Then two huge issues of public bonds. The investors become familiar with securities because the number of securities holder in France increase a lot at this occasion. then they are more willing to buy other securities. Often it happens that after war and the destruction, there is the reconstruction, so economic growth. The French government added to that with an important program of public expenditure to build an important network of railways, mainly more for military reason than for economic reason, but it added economic growth to the reconstruction. Then private agents see occasion of profits, and first of all, they create new banks. New banks with new aggressive commercial practices. For the first time, the bank officer leaves the office and visits people directly at home, for example. For the first time, these new banks buy or found financial journal that they distribute for free over the country. And there is an important number of caisse de repos, banks working on the repo market, that has been created. So here you can see some data about the crisis. Here in blue, you can see a stock index built by David Lebris, and as you can see, it spikes in 1881. Maybe the scale is not wonderful, but it roughly doubled between 1877 and 1881. In red, you have the discount rate of the central bank. In green, the free market rate, the monetary free market rate. In purple, the long-term interest rate. As you can see, these three variables spikes in 1881. What about traded volumes? In green, you have a proxy for the forward traded volumes. This variable is multiplied by a factor of 2 between 1880 and 1881. And also the spot volumes spike in 1881. Nevertheless, the crisis is a huge blow, but it didn't stop the development of the market over time, as you can see also from the number of listed securities on the two markets. Nevertheless, the impact on the real economy is important. The GDP recovers its 1881 level only in 1887. So here you can see the number of broker failures over the entire 19th century. And you can see that here also this variable spikes in 1882. No less than 14 broker over 60 went bankrupt. And the market really collapsed. The common fund was not enough to pay the debts of these 14 brokers. Then the central banks bailed out the market. The common fund in this, at this occasion has not been an adequate safety net against systemic shock. So it is the manifestation of the systemic dimension of the counterparty risk. Counterparty risk that, as I said before, the bourse tried to limit with this common fund. But we defined five periods according to the policy of the exchange in managing the counterparty risk. In the first one, it is no policy. In the second one, the common fund has been put in place, but its use is very limited. In the third period, modest control or moral reserve has been put in place, and the use of the common fund becomes more frequent. And after this huge crisis and the collapse of the market, the bailout of the central bank, the official market put in place and enforced control so on the moral hazard. And in the last period, from 1899 on, the control becomes really strong. So we are trying to explain, to see the impact of these changes in the policy about the counterparty risk management over the defaults of the broker. We have count data with evidence of over dispersion. So we have chosen a negative nominal regression. Here we have the market variables that we use. And we have five institutional dummies corresponding to the five regimes that I showed before. Here you have the model. And here you have the result. Well, as you can see, the two last institutional regime are significant in reducing the probability of the default. We are sure we run also other economic tests. I don't show them to you. Just keep in mind that the result of this test says that experience is very important in the in explaining the duration of the professional life of a broker. And if you keep in mind the debate I was mentioning, I mentioned before, it's clear that the member of the stockbrokers, member of the stock exchange committee, from the beginning of the 19th century up to the end, were the older and more experienced. And then this explains the dynamics between the assembly of the brokers and the stock exchange committee. So after 88, after this crisis, a new regime, a new tough regime is imposed. And of course, the official market loses business to the coulisses, to the OTC market. So in the view of the French government, this situation is not optimal. It is a macro structure based on a monopoly, a challenged monopoly, but also based on a monopoly. Why should we pay monopolistic rents to a market if first it fails, it collapses, and then it loses market share? Maybe a free market is better. That's why in 1893, the government removes the monopoly of the official market. Unfortunately for the OTC market, in 1896, there is a very important crisis that hits the OTC market, but the official market is not involved in this crisis. So the government changes its mind and it re-regulates the industry and put in place a really well enforced, this time, monopoly in 1898. So we have tested the effect of these two regulations of the market qualities. The question I have in mind is the one about the pros and the cons of different levels of fragmentation. So, fortunately, when the government liberalized the market, he has put in place also a financial transaction tax. That's why we can compare the market share of the official market in blue and of the OTC market in pink. Well, we have also some absolute data here. For the 1892, it seems that, I say it seems because we have to we have to be cautious about this data. I have no time to discuss them, but for the French Congress, the parquet, the official market in 1892, traded 35 billion francs, while the OTC market trades 75 billion francs. The GDP at the time is 23 billion. It means that the Paris financial market trade 4.8 times the French GDP in these years. Well, we don't know if the absolute level are absolutely accurate, but the proportion should be the right one, because in 1893, the result of the financial transaction tax showed the same proportion. And there is, between 94 and 95, an increase in the market share of the OTC market, and then in 96, a huge drop because of the crisis, as one mentioned. Here, the effect of the regulation, of the reestablishment of the monopoly, is quite, are really clear. Well, first consideration, in 1906, the official market trades 95 billion francs. That's a real data, it's a sound data, while the coulisse trades more or less 70 billion, is an estimate that we made. It means that more or less the French financial, the Paris financial center trades 5.8 times the French GDP of that time. That's quite an important measure. So, to assess the market quality, we have some different measures. Just I show you the spread as a proxy for the transaction cost. We have we calculated the implicit spreads using both ROL and GKN methods for a number of different portfolio based on the type of security, on the operation, forward spot, and on the market, OTC market, option market, with weekly prices. We have collected more than 40,000 prices over these 3 years. And that's more or less the result. In the system based on a challenged monopoly, in the competitive system, and here after the re-regulation. Well, it seems that the liberalization of the industry has increased the spread, while the re-regulation have strongly decreased the spread, the transaction cost for the investor. Why? But here the main issue is the transparency of the two markets. There are a lot of models in MicroStructure explaining that we have to expect lower spreads in more transparent markets. For sure, the official market was a very transparent one. On the contrary, the OTC was an opaque market. So I show just the summary of the econometric analysis that we ran in this paper. We regressed the spreads of on market variables and institutional dummies. The significant institutional dummies that we get are the market, OTC and official one, and the years. Then we can see that the movement of the spread you see there were explained by the institutional dummies. What's about the informational efficiency of the three regimes? We test for co-integration, and it's more frequent in 1894 than during the free market area regimes compared to 1892. But the co-integration in 1903, it means after the deregulation, is not so different from the 1894 levels. It means that the deregulation has a little negative impact. So, a kind of summary of this overview. Overall, the consistency of two markets, of two well-differentiated markets, is positive for the Paris Financial Center because it leads to a specialization and competition at the margin. Second, the mismanagement of the counterparty's risk in the option market imposes through regulation and creates scope for removing the monopoly. Third, the effect of the two regulation, the liberalization and the re-regulation, but they are a bit contradictory. I mean, there is a trade-off because on the one hand, the liberalization increases the transaction cost, but on the other hand, it increases the informational efficiency of the market. It means the circulation of the information between the official market and the OTC one. In terms of stability, clearly we have not a definitive conclusion, still we are working on, but on the short term, it seems that the liberalization facilitates the boom and the bust of 1896. On long term, we don't know because the experiment ends after 5 years. But what is clear is that the regulation doesn't stop the growth of the market as a whole. You have seen the trading volumes over the GDP increasing, and also the domestic market caps of over the GDP increases between 1900 and 1913. Then maybe a fact that we have to think about the 19 about the in order to assess the stability. The 1907 crisis is not a big problem at all in Paris, while it's dramatic in London and in New York. Okay, thanks so much for your attention.